So continuing on our theme of ecology, our next speaker is Mercedes Pascual. She's a professor at the University of Michigan. And her connection with SFI is she's a member both of the Science Board and the Science Steering Committee at SFI. She was trained as a theoretical ecologist and got her PhD from the MIT Woods Hole Oceanographic Joint Program. And that's okay. As soon as she's ready, I'll announce her topic. Okay. So today she'll be talking to us about pathogen diversity from an ecological perspective.
Thank you very much. And we just heard about this fascinating story about plants, and I like to follow about the world of smaller creatures, in particular pathogens. And we have here Andy Dobson, who can tell us that, in fact, most of diversity on Earth, but we don't have beautiful maps, is in fact attributable to parasites, right? Correct. So thank you. Anyhow, and these have and will continue to have in the future with the development in molecular epidemiology, molecular ecology, much to tell us about patterns, processes, and consequences of diversity. And I like to start with a quote from the most famous explorer of diversity, Charles Darwin, who wrote about a third principle, what he called the principle of divergence, and he wrote, the same spot will support more life if occupied by very diverse forms. This was in a letter to Asa Gray that well preceded his publication of The Origin of Species. Now, this principle is much less known than the two others, the one on heredity that speaks about descendancy with modification, the one on populations about the survival of the fittest. But I think it's a very interesting one, maybe about the quantity of life, but we can also interpret this as perhaps a question on the connection between diversity and the persistence or stability of life. And there has been a large body of theory in ecology on diversity at the level of community of species. These theories tend to fall into two camps. Of course, we have now this wonderful work on traits that we just heard about. But in terms of diversity per se, an emphasis on stochastic assembly processes and demography, extinction, immigration, etc., in the early work on island biogeography and the more recent neutral theory of Steve Hubble. At the opposite extreme, theories that emphasize local interactions such as competition, ideas of niches, limiting similarity, etc. And the differences between species that affect consumer resource dynamics have been structured into these two main axes by Peter Chesson, differences that depend on the frequency of the types and differences that are absolute and depend on the traits, but in a way that is independent from frequency dependence. And of course, neutral theory stands here at the origin, and I will talk mainly about this axis today. Now, it has been increasingly apparent that looking at empirical patterns of diversity and abundance does not help us to distinguish about hypotheses and dominant processes. And so community ecologists, at least in one line of work, have tried to look more at evolution and patterns, macroscopic patterns, that consider relatedness between species, phylogenetics, and how the traits are distributed on these trees. Now, this is a wonderful work that has some conceptual theory, some quantitative approaches, but as far as I can tell, no general theory so far. And I think that this is an area where the interface or the dialogue with what's happening in terms of understanding the diversity of pathogens would be extremely productive. And if you don't think of pathogens as consumer resource systems, and you like to think about something else than disease, well, think that, in fact, we have a very, very much a consumer resource system in which the host that is infected is the consumer. The resource are those individuals that are susceptible, and then those that acquire immunity are, in fact, the resource that has been consumed. These models are very well known, and they are the basis for population dynamics. Now, more recently, there has been increasing interest in the, an area now called phylodynamics, the interplay of population dynamics with basically pathogen, antigenic, and genetic diversity, where antigenic refers to the phenotype of these pathogens. This area has been given the name of phylodynamics by Grenfell and co-workers. It is, in a sense, a follow-up on the more general work on strain theory, the diversity in a population within a species of strains that form a population of pathogen. Now, I will tell you a little bit about work in this area today. And here is an outline of the talk. I will start with basically these competitive systems with evolution and show you that there are two very general dynamical regimes in these models. That is work motivated by seasonal influenza and the question of what limits the standing genetic and antigenic diversity of the virus. Then we'll move to systems that evolve not through mutation, but through recombination and reassortment of segments, genetic segments, and also to higher dimensional niche spaces. And there, I like to ask the question of whether competition for hosts can basically structure these pathogen populations into strains despite very high recombination. I will give you some examples of work in progress with another virus and with the wonderful Plasmodium falciparum malaria that is extremely puzzling in terms of diversity. So there will be a little bit about some preliminary empirical patterns, and I will close with some remarks that try to reconnect some of these, speculate a little bit on the implications for diversity and persistence, closing with this wonderful principle of Darwin. Now, we heard last year Derek Smith, who is here today, he gave us a wonderful talk about influenza and the patterns of its patterns of evolution. The virus, from the perspective of the immune system, the phenotype that is recognized by the immune system is mainly determined by two glycoproteins on the first surface of the virus, hemagglutinin, I cannot pronounce this, neuraminidase, and essentially H&M, and the types that we know, the subtypes, H1N1, H3N2, et cetera. Now, if you take the sequences of hemagglutinin that code for the sites that are seen that determine recognition by the immune system, you get this very characteristic shape of the phylogeny in which you see very short branches. Essentially, most variants go extinct, and this replacement of different phenotypes in different colors that tend to replace each other through time. And one question, at least for the theory, has been what determines basically the limiting standing diversity at any given time, this low diversity that you see given the extinction of these branches. So there have been different theories and wonderful work in that area. We contributed some ideas to this dynamics with a model of the punctuated evolution of H3N2 influenza. This is primarily work by two previous graduate students of mine, Katia Cole and Sarah Kobe. And I do not want to go over the details of this early work, just to point out that it coupled disease population dynamics with a genotype to phenotype map that was detailed and basically had the main property that most mutations were neutral, and occasionally some mutations had a phenotypic change that was important. This is, of course, coherent with much of some of the more detailed molecular work that is being done by others. But what I wanted to show you is that the behavior of this model is not the details of the genotype-phenotype map are not required for this kind of dynamics. They are part of a more general result in these competitive systems with evolution. So we can take these simpler models in which we represent a virus by essentially a discrete phenotype space, and each virus has a number of sites, and each site has a number of variants in the population. These sites can be considered a trait, a part of a molecule that is recognized by the immune system, and a strain is basically a repertoire, a combination of these variants, which are not physically linked, but determine a particular phenotype. In these models, mutation will represent change at the level of the phenotype. Now, early on, Sunetra Gupta and colleagues at Oxford published about these kinds of models in essentially systems of differential equations, and they showed two basic dynamics, one in which they showed us that strong selection causes these pathogen populations to segregate into discrete strains with non-overlapping repertoires, and another behavior with intermediate levels of selection where strain structure is unstable and has this cyclical or chaotic replacement. Now, strong selection here really means competition, the intensity of competition due to immunity at the population level. Now, they adapted this model, at least conceptually, they propose it as a model for seasonal influenza in this regime that has these cyclical replacements. But these models, as I said, were implemented as differential equations. They did not have extinction, explicit extinction. They did not have explicit evolution, so we couldn't follow the macroscopic evolutionary patterns that emerge from these dynamics. And essentially, the dynamics were all ecological at the population level. When a niche opened up because of these frequency-dependent dynamics, the types that were there at low level could invade if they were the appropriate type. And by appropriate, I mean given the configuration of what the individuals had seen in their previous exposure at the population level. So we collaborated with Sunetra to say what would happen if we incorporate explicit evolution into these models. And the question is influenza in a regime we call selection limited, essentially all the dynamics is driven by competition and frequency dependence, or is it limited by the mutation rate, the appearance of innovation in the system, so that when a niche opens up, you basically have to wait. We developed an individual-based model that tracks individuals and their immune history, and then the risk of infection is a function of how close in some sort of distance this infecting strain is to the essentially history of infection of the virus. We don't have a genotype to phenotype map, so we have to create some trees. We basically tracked the whole tree, the whole descendancy of the virus computationally. And we can subsample this tree rather than creating sequences. So this is very convenient. We, on the right, you then can define a distance. You can track diversity by going from two strains back to their common ancestor, this distance in time is average over the population, and that is a form of genetic diversity. You can vary competition by saying, well, how does the risk of infection depend on how many of those sites have you encountered before? And you can also calculate a very interesting quantity. The image doesn't come very well here. You can see what's the rate of mutation along the trunk of the tree, that's the types that survive, versus the rate of mutation for the branches which go extinct. This quantity is bigger than one if you have positive selection in the system, and it's smaller than one if these changes are negatively selected. The main result I wanted to show you was this one. Here we have no evolution, this is just neutral dynamics, but there are here two different regimes. For a small mutation rate, you see the typical qualitative dynamics of influenza. This is in a large population, well-mixed population of 40 million people, showing this boom and bust dynamics. But if you increase the rate of innovation in this system, then you get this coexistence of different types. These trees coalesce in the past. I'm just showing you the last 40 years in the figure. What these pathogens have done is to find these niches, basically achieve some limiting similarity, and partition this immunity space at the level of the population into niches so that they don't compete strongly with each other anymore. And anything that tries to invade has a very hard job because it's negatively selected the way they have partitioned the space. But interestingly, these dynamics cannot occur if the mutation rate is low because you can't establish those niches. And just to this, and I apologize, I don't know why if you can see the figures very well, but this whole space of competition strength versus the speed of evolution, we have here the different genetic diversity of the virus. There is some trivial diversity. If competition is weak, you just have a lot of diversity because, well, they don't see each other. If mutation rate is very fast, you just have completely non-structured diversity. But in the middle, you have the high diversity in this frequency-dependent regime in which the viruses have found these different niches. And those dynamics were for just general parameters, but you can use parameters more closely related to H3N2 influenza. And if you could see the colors, you would see also this is a simulation with a northern hemisphere, a southern hemisphere out of space, and the tropics, 90 million people. And you can also, besides the tree, the right time of the replacement of these clusters, you can also see the predominance of the trunk in the tropics, all features of the dynamics, and so on. Now, I wanted to point out that these dynamics do not depend on the details of how you represent the phenotype. So we consider discrete traits, but you could also consider a continuous space in which a virus is defined by its position in this space of traits. And this is similar to the maps that Derek Smith has shown us, in which he takes the distances from these immunity assays between the different types, and he establishes a map in continuous two dimensions. And here, this is a simulation in which we have 10 dimensions. It doesn't matter. And you can see that as long as this phenotypic mutation is low, the virus moves in one dimension in this cluster, progressing through these different clusters. And that's the principal component of this 10-dimensional space. So what I'm showing you is that in this competitive dynamics with evolution, regarding of how you represent the traits, you have these two different regimes, and that this transition between these two regimes does not only depend on the strength of competition, as has been emphasized before, but very critically and not surprisingly on the evolutionary rate. And that H3N2 appears mutation limited, so that you need to explicitly model not just the ecological dynamics, but its evolutionary dynamics to generate the right macroscopic patterns for the diversity of both the trees and the abundance. Now, similar models have been developed for evolution through not mutation, but reassortment or recombination of segments. And in particular, there is this second regime, which applies here, in which despite high recombination and reassortment, you can have a structure of this second regime in which you have these strains that emerge from the dynamics, and they have non-overlapping repertoires. Now, these non-overlapping repertoires imply correlations between traits that are not physically linked, but a correlation that emerges from the dynamics. Now, I'd like to show you some evidence that perhaps some of that is indeed happening. And of course, which kind of dynamics we have matters for how we develop vaccines, and also, as I will try to show later, for how persistent the virus may be or the pathogen may be when we intervene. So this is another wonderful creature, and we are moving at another level of organization from thinking about mutations at the site and thinking about now segments of genetic material. Rotavirus is responsible for most diarrheal disease in children. And it is a virus with basically 11 segments, a very simple virus with these 11 segments that are completely known. So we know what each of them codes for. And in particular, I like to point your attention two segments and two particular proteins on the surface of the virus, the so-called VP7 responsible for the types that are called G, and VP4, the P types that are responsible for these spikes. Now, these two together form the outside capsule of the virus, and therefore are the ones that the immune system will see the most. So you can ask, well, what happens? This virus recombines these segments each time it co-infects a host. Now, you can take a data set of sequences. We did this for sequences from a surveillance program by the developers of a vaccine for rotavirus, and these are sequences from the globe. It's a small set of sequences, under 200. But we asked this question of whether we saw linkage between these different types, despite reassortment. And to make a long story short, you can basically construct trees, but now for individual segments, and use some bioinformatic approaches to find places where reassortment must have occurred. This analysis tells you reassortment occurred and these segments were involved. Then we ask, how often did the segments stay together despite reassortment? And if you look at that for VP4 and VP7, they stayed together above 50% of the time, around 0.7, in a frequency that is found to be significant with different types of randomizations. But if you compare this non-structural protein and its association with these types, well, they never stay together. They almost never stay together. And this is not physical linkage. This is dynamical linkage at the population level. So essentially, this virus, it's not just a mixing of the segments. It can have a very particular structure that tends to basically avoid overlap and maybe has a signature of competition. So if this is not interesting enough, I'd like to introduce you to another system which, from the perspective of the immune system, is just amazing. And I should say, maybe it's the kind of system that if you were reasonable, you wouldn't try to study. It's just some people say, because this is completely far from a model system like rotavirus, which in a sense you know what every segment codes for. But I think it's a fascinating exploration on the diversity that is out there. And how these pathogens evade the immune system. This is a vector-borne infection. Most of you know it basically has a part of the cycle in the mosquito and an asexual part of the cycle in the red blood cells in the humans. And I like to focus on this question of whether when we say malaria, do we really just have one parasite, or do we have a collection of strains out there? And it makes a lot of a difference for why we are not successful when we intervene. So this is diversity from the perspective of a single antigen, but a major antigen. It's called EMP1, again, impossible to pronounce. I will not try, I can tell you what it stands for, but it is a surface protein encoded by a multi-copy family of extremely diverse genes. So think now not of many pools of variants, but a single pool of variants that basically can occupy 50 to 60 genes in the different chromosomes of this wonderful creature. Now, this protein is expressed in the surface of infected red blood cell, and it has several functions. But I like to focus on how it evades the immune system. And basically what the parasite does, so here a parasite is 50 to 60 of these genes. It is inside the blood cell, it expresses it in the surface, and it shows you the cards in progression. So it shows you progressively the different types. So it's doing this, presumably, to evade the immune system. Now, this is a single parasite. Within a human host that is infected, there are waves of parasitemia in terms of total numbers of parasites. And each of those is dominated by the expression of one of those types. So somehow the whole population of parasites is coordinating this sort of showing the cards to the immune system. I will not go on the theories that explain how they do this coordination. There are some different theories and we don't truly understand it. I will take it as given that an infection has this sequential expression of traits that the immune system recognizes. Now, my wonderful colleague, Karen Day, is doing this very, very challenging work of asking if you go to a population in Africa or some other place in the world, how big is the pool of these variants? Well, it's enormous, at least from the perspective of the sequences, the nucleotide sequences. And this is shown here by this typical way we plot diversity in ecology. This is how many sequences you have sampled, and then you accumulate how many new types you have. And this is diversity just in terms of a threshold of at the nucleotide level of 96% divergence. But you can see that in places in South America and New Guinea of low transmission, this tends to saturate around 100. In places in Africa of high transmission, this diversity hasn't saturated at close to 1,000. And if you do some of those wonderful calculations of where it should saturate, well, a few thousand. So you can do in your head, if you were a parasite that can combine, just pick at random, of course, they don't do this, but pick at random 50 of these thousands of variants in a population. And that's the combinations you may have if, of course, all of these were neutral other than from the perspective of the immune system. So we wanted to see what would happen if we let these parasites compete under high recombination. This will not surprise you if you have done competition models, but this is an individual-based model that will, again, track each host and its history of infection. And now we have some biting events because of this vector transmission. So the mosquito can bite two people, and there will be, again, this protection against the types that you have seen before. Now, interestingly, when the mosquito bites a person that has more than one type, there can be recombination. And so we implement that. And we also have some rules for within host dynamics, which we implement as rules, but we can also do it as really temporal dynamics. The important thing is that within the host, we can have rules that match the different findings on how these strains interact within the host. For example, you can have a parasite just wait until another has finished expression, et cetera, et cetera. But everything I showed you does not depend on the particular rules of co-infection. This is the main result. We see in these models, and this is a simple simulation in which we just consider six sites and 50, a pool of 50, very far, of course, from the real full diversity. But what we see emerging and under low recombination is essentially a dominant set of coexisting non-overlapping types. Each color here represents the numbers that of a particular repertoire. So we have stacked them on top of each other, and the little gray stuff here are all the other types that are present, but really at low abundance. And so we can increase recombination to very high levels. What we see is more of these instabilities moving through the system, but essentially over epidemiological times, still a structure that is fairly organized into strains, and again, strains that do not overlap much with each other. I would like to point out that the existence of repertoires, again, implies associations between different strain types in this kind of dynamics. Now, could we test for this? Well, the problem is that the data that exists out there, even the big data, is too small for this diversity. The diversity is just too deep for us to describe structures. So we set up this project with Karen Day. She's the molecular expert, the molecular epidemiology in Ghana, to basically go to some villages and sample through time and through a major intervention this diversity very deeply in these populations. We have started, I can't show you the full, I can show you a lot of analysis. We have, for example, a pilot in which we sample 700 individuals in this population and sequence these genes. We means Karen's lab. I know nothing about it. But the surprising thing is she told me in the dry, this is the dry season, low transmission, how many people had parasites, 40% of the population, and these are not the symptomatic, these are not the people in the clinic, these are the asymptomatic people walking around with no symptoms. So what we are trying to characterize is the diversity of the parasite in this huge asymptomatic reservoir. So when you think about intervention, you can think about how do you really eliminate a parasite that does this, and that does this perhaps with some structure. So let me show you an attempt. We are beginning to try to look at this, but it is unfortunate that even in the pilot with 200 sequences, we had of the order of 10,000 types. This is types at the levels of sequences. But we have some beginning evidence that there are some of these associations and these types that, and certainly there is structure that is different from random. So I showed you just one picture here because I want to get to the implications of all this. If we simplify the data by looking at those that had a single infection, so we could be sure that this was a repertoire, and we also consider the var types that were present more than once, which I will tell you were only between 100 and 200, not 10,000, right? This shows you how many rare types there are. Well, we looked at whether if we constructed networks of high linkage, which is a measure of association, and thresholded these, whether there were modules in these networks. And what we are looking is at whether there are these modules of highly linked sequences. And in fact, we find significant, not huge modularity, because again, we are not looking at this very deeply. We also find cliques that are present in many of those single infection individuals. And very interestingly, for those interested in population genetics, we also have the part of the genome that is completely neutral. And we know that this relatedness cannot be explained by the relatedness of the neutral part of the genome. So this is an interesting story. So what? Let me finish before they kick me out of the podium. Let's return to Darwin's idea about diversity and perhaps persistence. We saw that, of course, intervening in this kind of structure where things are strains and not a mixed bag of genetic diversity, you know, will matter. We see in the models that if we deal with bigger pools, we get these more stable dynamics. But also, we see that this modular strain structure that results and emerges from this frequency-dependent dynamics should be more susceptible to non-targeted interventions. So let's imagine that you just go and treat 80% of the population with drugs to clear their parasites. Well, you are going to clear more diversity than if this was a random mixing of types. And this happens here in these simulations that unfortunately you cannot see. I will blame the Mac because this was not produced in a Mac. But the idea is here, this is work by my wonderful previous postdoc, Yael Arsi, who is now a faculty in Amsterdam. Basically here we have some dynamics that is fairly stable with these different types. And you hit it with this, in the simulations, with this mass administration of drugs that remove the parasite from a large section of the population. You are not just decreasing prevalence, you are decreasing diversity very strongly and you cannot see it. It drops very, very rapidly and it recovers much more slowly than prevalence itself. The idea is that then you have switched the system into this oscillatory behavior that has much deeper troughs. Perhaps you can hit it again with another kind of intervention. It should be more susceptible to elimination. So that's a bit of speculation. I like to close by saying that, of course, all of this, I believe, has relevance not just to pathogens, but to what we should see in communities of species when they compete and for resources. In fact, this is an interesting piece of work on a competition model in which you have a single axis that determines a trait that influences the competition. And this work by Schaefer and Van Ness shows that what emerges through time as this system evolves are these clumps of species that have established limiting similarity. Well, this is completely analogous to what we see in our second regime. And so what I'm saying here is that in the future, perhaps we should be able to have a general theory for macroscopic patterns of diversity that couple evolution and ecology that is applicable to different kinds of systems in terms of the patterns, and that this can guide how do we apply inference methods at the interface of computation and statistics to basically identify the dominant processes that are at play to establish competition. And we have examples of this already in the very active developments in phylogeography. I think these two things should come together. But ultimately, perhaps we can get a better understanding of this third principle of Darwin, of how does this diversity matter for more life. Thank you very much.
Can you tell us something about whether there are actually signals of natural selection on the sequences that are taken from within a given host? Say, for example, the ratio of non-synonymous to synonymous changes in the DNA?
Yes, I have to say one problem with looking at that, and of course that's an interesting question, is that the sequences of this, the part of the genome that is sequenced in the var genes is so variable that it's very, very difficult to align it. So a lot of the normal population genetic studies that you do are very difficult because it's very difficult to align the sequences. Now this has changed recently, and this is, I think, a very interesting feature of this system of how does the parasite create so much diversity. Bioinformaticians have taken the seven genomes of falciparum, seven arbitrary genomes that have been sequenced, and have defined little motifs in the amino acids that essentially are what they call, well, homology. They have an evolutionary homology in a sense of being conserved and show descendancy. These motifs are parts of the sequences now that you can align, and this opens up a lot of opportunities. So how does the virus generate a lot of variation? It doesn't do this by mutating. It does by essentially reassembling these small motifs into different sequences. So I think converting these sequences to these sequences of motifs takes us a lot farther into function. It goes and also into questions of looking at specific sites. So there we are at the moment, and we have been able to identify, for example, specific mutations that are significantly polymorphic in the population, and that correlate with age and should have some epidemiological significance. But if you think about it, I don't think this system is varying very much. It's creating enormous diversity by recombining these small pieces. So each type is a combination of these pieces. And so, again, this, I think, it's a recent development, but one that allows us to go from 10,000 variants to around 1,000. So to sort of coarse grain the diversity at a level that I think should be functionally more interesting. So anyhow, that's...
Other questions?
Yes.
I mean, those clusters that you do see appear, can you associate those with a origin at a specific location, and do they spread from that, and how long do they last for?
Well, yes, we still, this was the first sample, so I can't tell you about seasonal variation, but certainly we will begin to look at not just spatial variation, but in terms of that structure, also how it relates to other features. For example, other these sequences are known to exist in certain clusters that can recombine more with each other. We want to look at age, we want to look at space, and look at how this is organized through time, and also how, when you intervene in this system, how does this diversity or this structure change? So far we can't. I mean, but that's the idea behind this project. What we have seen is that we have analyzed the neutral part of the genome, the microsatellites, and we don't see much spatial structure at all. In fact, we don't see significant structure there. So the system seems fairly well mixed at the scales we are considering in these villages.
Other questions? So it's now time for our break, so we should thank our... another question.
I wanted to point out that with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which actually kills more people than malaria every year, the amount of sequences that have been fully sequenced of the bacterium, which in Russia alone now is 1,000 full sequences, about 4 million base pairs, it's actually been very difficult to find anything that's under positive selection. And most of the selection appears to be of a purifying kind, so that the mutations are actually going to go away.
Yes.
So it indicates that in something like malaria, unless the competition is of a particular kind, which you're talking about, frequency-dependent selection, most of the mutations are likely to be neutral or purifying.
Yeah, well, it's very interesting that you point out this example, because the only regime in which you would see positive selection is in the one I showed for influenza, where you see that the spindly tree moving along and being replaced by positively selected mutations. In the regime of influenza. That model in the regime where it creates more diversity is under negative selection. And the results we have for rotavirus would suggest that what you have in action is negative selection. Now for malaria, again, because it is a game about recombination, and really it is about using conserved pieces to create a lot of diversity. But then that will be structured by negative selection. So that's the picture I was trying to give. Now, whether that is strong enough to have a signal, again, it remains to be seen. Maybe we have a well-mixed pathogen, but I think it makes a difference. In fact, the R0 of malaria, this reproductive number of how many secondary infections a single infected can produce, has been in the literature from 3 to 3,000, absurd numbers if you look at the levels of transmission. But if you consider that you have a structured population, the way we measure R0 breaks down. And so it also breaks down for how we think about intervention.